and welcome to Once Upon a Time, your favorite storytelling television and media show. Anyway, I'm Catherine Poulter, and
I am Becca Hyde.
And we have so many really good books to read to you today. This week, I was thinking about gardens, and I remembered that there was a wonderful book about a little girl and her pet squash. So I thought I would read, first of all, Sophie's Squash. This is by Pat Zeitlau Miller, and it's illustrated by Annie Vilsdorf. Here we go. Sophie's Squash. One bright fall day, Sophie chose a squash at the farmer's market. Her parents planned to serve it for supper. But Sophie had other ideas. It was just the right size to hold in her arms, just the right size to bounce on her knee, just the right size to love. "I'm glad we met," Sophie whispered. "Good friends are hard to find." At home, Sophie used markers to give her squash a face. Then she wrapped it in a blanket and rocked it to sleep. When it was time to make supper, Sophie's mother looked at the squash. She looked at Sophie. "I call her Bernice," Sophie said. "I'll call for a pizza," said her mother. After that, Bernice went everywhere with Sophie. To story time at the library, to visit other squash at the farmer's market, to practice somersaults by the garden. Every night, Sophie gave Bernice a bottle, a hug, and a kiss. "Well, we did hope she'd love vegetables," Sophie's mother told her father. "Shh," Sophie said. "Bernice is sleeping." "Sweet pea," Sophie's mother said one morning as they made blueberry waffles. "Bernice is a squash, not a friend. If we don't eat her soon, she'll get mushy and gross. Let's bake her with marshmallows. Wouldn't that taste yummy?" "Don't listen, Bernice," Sophie cried. That afternoon, Sophie's father took her shopping. "Sugar beet," he said. "Bernice is a squash. Why don't you pick a nice toy to play with instead?" But the trucks were too hard and the dolls were too soft. Sophie clutched Bernice tightly. "No thanks," she said. "I have everything I need." After supper, Sophie's parents called a family meeting. Bernice napped in Sophie's lap. "Why don't we donate Bernice to the food pantry before she rots?" her father suggested. Sophie shook her head. "Bernice will last forever." "Bernice seems a little blotchy," said Sophie's dad on the way to the library one day. "She looks perfectly fine to me," Sophie replied. At story time, the kids pointed and stared. "What's that spotty thing?" a boy asked. "Her name is Bernice, and she is a squash," Sophie said, "with freckles." "Maybe Bernice should stay home next time," Sophie's mom suggested. "Why?" Sophie asked. "She wasn't the one being rude." Still, as winter neared, Sophie noticed changes. Bernice seemed softer, and her somersaults lacked their usual style. "Visiting friends will cheer you up," Sophie said. At the farmer's market, squash were everywhere, firm, shiny squash. "What keeps a squash healthy?" Sophie asked a farmer. "It's simple, really," he said. "Fresh air, good clean dirt, a little love." "Well," Sophie thought, "I have all that." At home, Sophie cleared leaves from Bernice's favorite spot. She made a bed of soft soil, tucked Bernice in, and kissed her goodnight. "Get better soon," she whispered. That night, while Sophie slept and the wind whistled and tiny snowflakes fell, when she awoke, the world was covered in white. Do you think Bernice is cold out there? Sophie asked her mother.
I am sure she's warm and cozy under her snow blanket, her mother replied.
Sophie gazed out the window all morning. She was still there in the afternoon when her father came home with a surprise.
You need a new friend, he said.
Meet Ace. Ace was nice, but boring. He just swam around and around in his bowl. But during the long winter, Sophie discovered Ace was a super silent reader who did fabulous flip turns. And she always listened politely when she talked about Bernice. Bernice was great at keeping secrets, she's saying. When the snow finally melted, Sophie rushed to the garden. The only thing there was a small green sprout. It looked strangely familiar. Bernice, Sophie said, how was your winter? After that, Sophie, Ace, and Bernice ate lunch together every day. One bright summer morning, Sophie somersaulted across her yard. She landed by the garden and stared in disbelief. Bernice had grown two tiny squash. Wow, Sophie told them, you look just like your mom. Soon, Bonnie and Baxter were just the right size for Sophie to hold in her arms and bounce on her knee. Just the right size to love. The end.
Bernie and Baxter.
Yes.
Let's have another story about a fall.
Oh, good idea.
Item of produce, apples.
Very
apples
nice.
Apples and robins. This is a lovely book by Lucie Felix. And it has some lovely art cutouts. All you need for apples are circles and the color red. Summer is ending. The apples hang high on the tree, just out of reach. All you need for a ladder are 6 rectangles, 5 short, and 1 long. And you can climb into the leafy branches to pick an apple. All you need to take a bite are 2 circles. An apple is a circle. An open mouth is a circle. And a bite of apple is so sweet. But someone else thinks so too. Ooh, a worm. All you need for a bird are 3 bright triangles, like the robin's whistle, and a red oval like its round red breast. It will fly away with the worm and sit in my apple tree, singing. All you need for a birdhouse are walls and a roof and a little door. And a piece of strong string to hang it with. Now there is a place for a robin's nest. But all you need for a storm is for the wind to blow and the sky to rumble. Crash.
Oh.
Crack. Isn't that clever? Upset in the storm. Oh, what a mess. But we'll rake the leaves and gather the apples. All you need for a basket is an empty place to put things. all you need for a birdhouse is a hammer and some nails. I'll climb the ladder and hang the birdhouse and take the apples in to eat. All winter there will be apples. There will be robins. And one morning when you're making your breakfast, an egg will crack in the robin's nest. There will be baby robins and apple flowers. It will be spring.
Oh, that's beautiful.
I think so too.
Well,
beautiful book.
Because you brought that one, I brought another one with a cutout. A little peek-through picture book. It says, this book is called Tree, and it's by Britta Teckentrup. And it has a hole in it. And the other morning I was walking, and I saw, sitting in a tree, an owl.
Ooh.
It was very beautiful. Here we go. Tree. By Britta Teckentrup. In the forest, all is still, gripped by winter's icy chill. Owl sits watching his tree. No one sees as much as he. Snow is melting all around. Shoots are peeping through the ground. In the trees, young bear cubs play. Spring cannot be far away. Oh, look, there are two little bear cubs. Blossoms fall and leaves are growing. A gentle springtime breeze is blowing. Squirrels scamper here and there. Playful fox cubs sniff the air. Birds flit through the leafy bowers. The forest is abloom with flowers. Birds are singing, foxes play. Summertime is on its way. Now summer's here, the sun is high. Bees are humming in the sky. Juicy apples, ripe and sweet, almost ready for you to eat. On a warm midsummer's night, all the stars are shining bright. The trees sway gently to and fro, shimmering in the moonlit glow. Look at all these animals in there now. Now it's cooler all around. Apples tumble to the ground. Grass is damp with morning dew. Clouds drift across the skies of blue. Autumn leaves turn red and gold. Days are warm and nights grow cold. Food is gathered and stored away, ready for a winter's day. The cold north wind begins to blow. Animals shiver. It starts to snow. Time to shelter, find a bed. Prepare for winter months ahead. The forest floor is snowy white. In his tree, owl sits tight. Deep midwinter's here once more. Wise owl has seen it all before. It's silent now. No sounds are heard. Not a fox cub, not a bird. The trees are still. The snow lies deep. All the forest has gone to sleep. The seasons have all come and gone. Snow has fallen. Sun has shone. Owl sees the first new buds appear. And so begins another year. The end.
That is absolutely gorgeous.
It's so beautiful. Yes.
And I have a book that tells a story that I really love. The name of this book is Ada's Violin, and it is the story of the recycled orchestra of Paraguay. Hmm. And this book is a true story. It's written by Susan Hood and illustrated by Sally Wren Comfort. Ada Rios woke up in a town made of trash. Every morning at dawn, Ada heard the first garbage trucks rumble and roll down the road to Carretera. Beep, 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 beep. Backing into the landfill, they tipped their loads up and up and crash. The trash came rumbling down, 1,500 tons each day. Ada and her friends watched as the guarderos scrambled and teamed and tearing into plastic bags with long-handled hooks, pushing aside moldy produce and grabbing anything they could recycle or sell. The going rates, 5 cents for a pound of cardboard, 10 cents for a pound of plastic. The noisy, rumbling, stinking, sweltering slum was not the most nurturing neighborhood. Ada watched, eyes wide, but she didn't say much. And yet, she liked to imagine each garbage truck was a box of surprises. One never knew what might be inside. Her father had found appliances, toys, perfumes, and antique watches. One woman even discovered a small box full of gold jewelry. Little did Ada know there was a bigger surprise waiting for her in the landfill. Every day, when Ada's parents went to work, grandmother cared for Ada and her little sister. Grandma loved to sing rock and roll songs from the 1960s. The girls grew up to the tunes of the Beatles, Simon and Garfunkel, and Creedence Clearwater Revival. Ada loved to sing too, but only when no one was listening. Ada's dad brightened the night with stories and songs of great musicians. He turned up the radio and pointed out the sounds each instrument made. Ada heard one above all others. Zing went the strings of the violin. When the girls started school, Grandma returned to work as a recycler collecting bottles and cans in the city. Classes let out at noon. Young Ada was in charge of her sister until her parents were done with work. At first, the girls stayed close to home, playing with Grandma Miriam's doggies and making sandcastles in the dirt. But soon they joined their cousins, playing hide and seek or a game of handball in the street. In time, they ventured farther afield, walking down to the bodega to get candy. But Ada noticed the teenagers hanging out in the alleys, grumbling about life in the landfill looming ahead. What would happen to them, to her little sister? She watched as the other kids turned to gangs and got into fights. One day when Ada was 11 years old, her grandmother saw a sign posted on the wall of the chapel. Violin, guitar, cello, taught Saturdays at 8 a.m. Fabio Chavez. How Grandma had longed to learn music. Too late for her, maybe, she thought, but not for her granddaughters. She signed them up without asking them or their parents. Ada's heart sang out. Thanks to her abuela, she could leave her worries behind and learn to play. At the first class, the teacher, Fabio Chavez, had 3 guitars and 2 violins to share. Ada chose a violin right away, but 10 children had signed up. Frustrated, Ada and her friends found that there were not enough instruments to go around. And there was a bigger problem. Everyone quickly realized that the children would need to practice at home, but it wasn't safe to be seen with an expensive instrument in their town, where a violin is worth more than a house. Watching the children play amid broken glass and rusty metal, Señor Chavez knew he had to do something. He remembered a band called Les Luthiers that made its own instruments. That was it. He asked Nicolas Cola Gomez, a gambero, and carpenter for help. Senor Gomez found a discarded drum with a big hole in it. What could he use to fix it? He picked through the trash and discovered an old X-ray film. Would that work? It did. Senor Gomez kept experimenting, and others helped. Inventing instruments wasn't easy, but they found, if they fiddled and discovered, they could find materials that did just the right notes. They transformed oil drums into cellos, water pipes into flutes, and packing crates into guitars. Soon there were enough instruments for all the children who wanted to play. Ada chose a violin made from an old paint can, an aluminum baking tray, a fork, and pieces of wooden crates. Worthless to thieves, it was invaluable to her. It was a violin of her very own. Senor Chavez set up a strict schedule of three-hour lessons. The class had no classroom, so they played outside, despite the heat and sudden downpours. At first, Ada and the others struggled. Sharps and flats clanged and clashed. Playing an instrument is a process. It doesn't matter if one is rich or poor, ugly, thin. You cannot learn to play an instrument overnight. Senor Chavez told the children. Some kids decided it was too much work and gave up, but not Ada. After lessons, she would practice at home, sometimes 2 hours a day. In time, the screeches, twangs, and tweezes all hit the right notes. Their class became a small island where Chavez taught them to respect themselves and one another. Be kind. Always say please and thank you. Say you're sorry. Be dedicated when you commit to something, Senor Chavez told the children. Soon, the ragtag crew of kids learned to tune in, to listen to one another, to band together. The recycled orchestra was born. From then on, there was something new in the air. Garderos trudging home from the landfill might lift their heads to hear the sounds of Ada's violin, or the strains of Baby's cello, or the strum of Noelia's guitar. A symphony of sound helped to lift them beyond the heat, the stench, and their aching backs. With her violin, Ada could close her eyes and imagine a different life. She could soar on the high, bright, bittersweet notes to a place far away. She could be who she was meant to be. As Ada's skill grew, so did her confidence. Once timid, she now took center stage playing solos. She helped teach the younger children too. Her teachers and fellow students took note. When she was 12 years old, Ada was named a first violinist. Imagine, she was first at something. Shortly after, she and her 39 fellow musicians were invited to perform concerts. And later, in the nearby capital city of Asuncion, word of this extraordinary orchestra spread. Soon they were asked to perform in other cities and even other countries. Ada and her friends flew on their first airplane, stayed in their first hotel, swam in the bright blue waters of Rio de Janeiro, sampled their first pastries and pineapple, and saw sights they never imagined. The world dazzled them, just as they dazzled the world. When Ada was 16, the orchestra received a very special invitation. They were asked to tour with a world-famous rock band. More than 35,000 people awaited them at their first concert stop in Bogota, Colombia. Ada was more than nervous. She didn't know how to enter or how to greet the audience. She went blank. She saw a giant stage with glaring lights and heard people screaming. But she didn't have to worry. As the recycled orchestra took stage, the people who had paid to see the rock band cheered for them. The enormous audience sang and swayed to the music as the orchestra played, and as their performance came to a close, a crescendo of cheers, chants, and applause resounded across the park. The astonished kids bowed, grinning at one another. They had discovered the surprise waiting in the landfill. Buried in the trash was music, and buried in themselves was something to be proud of. Yeah.
The power of beautiful music. Yes. And I have a book about the power of reading.
Oh, good.
This is one of my favorite books. Well, so many books are favorite, but I love this one. It's called The Little Old Man Who Could Not Read. It's by Irma Simonton Black, and the pictures are by Seymour Fleischman. The Little Old Man Who Could Not Read. And let me think. I'm just going to look in the very back. This book was printed in 1968, so it is a very old book. I remember it when I was a little girl. Here we go. Once there was a little old man who could not read. He just never wanted to learn. His wife went to the shop and bought the food, but the little old man stayed at home and made beautiful toys out of wood. Children all over the world loved his toys, and many wrote to tell him so, but still the little old man never wanted to learn to read. One day his wife decided to go on a visit. "You will need to go to the shop," she said. "Get a tin of soup and a big tin of spaghetti sauce and some spaghetti. Get some sugar and some milk and some oatmeal. Eat well." And she kissed the old man and left. The old man went to the shop. There were rows and rows of tins with pictures on them. And there were rows and rows of tins and packets without pictures. Where were they? The little old man did not know, and he didn't like to ask. He bought a middle-sized tin. It looked like the tins of soup his wife brought home. He bought a long packet that looked like a spaghetti packet, and a big tin that looked like a spaghetti sauce tin. He bought a blue packet that looked like a sugar packet. He bought a round packet that looked like an oatmeal packet. And at last of all, he bought a square carton. It looked like the milk cartons his wife brought home. "Ah," said the little old man when he got home, "that walk made me hungry. I shall have some hot soup for lunch." He opened the middle-sized tin. It was onion soup. The little old man hated onions of any kind, and onion soup was worst of all. "Fiddle," he said, "onion soup. I shall save it for my good wife." At dinner time, the little old man rubbed his hands with pleasure and took down the long packet that looked like a spaghetti packet, and the great big tin that looked like a spaghetti sauce tin. Beaming, he opened the long packet, but the packet did not have spaghetti in it. It had wax paper. "Fiddlesticks and fish fur," he said. "Who wants to eat wax paper? Even with sauce on it. Not I, for one, but I can eat the sauce all by itself." He reached for the big tin. For the first time, he noticed that it had a plastic top on it, so he took it off. "That's funny," he said to himself. "I never saw a plastic top on a sauce tin. I do hope this isn't a coffee tin." He opened the big tin. It was a coffee tin. The coffee smelled delicious, but it wasn't much good for a hungry little old man. "Shall I have my oatmeal and sugar instead?" he asked himself. "With milk?" Then he answered himself, "No. I'll have a cup of coffee and go to bed. In the morning, I'll have a nice big breakfast." By the next morning, he was very, very hungry. "Oatmeal," said the little old man as he jumped out of bed. "I shall put on lots and lots of milk and sugar." Ah! The little old man got the round packet and the blue packet and the square carton. He put them all on the table. Then he opened the round packet.
There was no oatmeal in it. It was full of something grainy and white. The old man tasted it carefully.
Salt?
Fiddles and flute, said the old man. Who wants milk and sugar on salt? He opened the blue packet and got a spoon to have a sweet taste of sugar, but there was no sugar in the packet. It was full of little white flakes.
Soap?
Said the old man sadly. Who wants soap, even with milk? Oh, how hungry I am. He opened the square carton to get a drink of milk. But the milk in the carton smelled funny. It was buttermilk. It was sour, sour buttermilk. The old man hated buttermilk, but he was so hungry that he drank every drop of it. The old man hated onion soup, but at noon he was so hungry that he ate the onion soup. At night, his wife came back. The old man was very glad to see her. Wife, he said, I had a bad time. He told her how he got all mixed up with the tins and the cartons and the packets. The long packet was not spaghetti, it was wax paper. The blue packet was soap flakes. The round packet was salt. Wife, please teach me to read. Very well, I shall, said his good wife. First, the old man learned to read the word spaghetti. Next, he learned to read the word milk. Then he learned to read the big words for everything in the shop. And then he learned to read the words for everything in the world. Automobiles, library, colossal. The Daily News says, little old man learns to read. Sail, go, stop, TV. But he still made his beautiful toys out of wood, and now he could read the letters the children sent him. And he never, no, never went hungry again. The end.
Yay!
Yay.
Excellent. Reading lessons for the little old man.
Yes.
And here we have a book about lion lessons by John Agee, who is also the illustrator. And here's our boy walking down the street. There are many things to learn, like Spanish, knitting, yoga, karate, learn the violin, baking, and the store for lion lessons. 7 easy steps. It's not easy getting your lion diploma. I know. I took lessons. My teacher was a pro. There are 7 steps to becoming a lion, he said. But first, we must stretch. And on the wall it says, Harvard School of Claw, Society of Big Cats, Purple Pounce Award. Here they are stretching. We did the upward lion and the downward lion, the upside down lion, the rolling lion, the flying lion, and we shook our manes. Step 1 was looking fierce. Watch me, said the lion. You bare your claws, gnash your teeth, and show your fangs. I tried out my 3 most frightening poses. The lion wasn't impressed. Step 2 was roaring. It's simple, said the lion. Take a deep breath and roar as loud as you can into the microphone. Rawr, rawr, rawr. I took a deep breath and roared as loud as I could. That needs work, said the lion. Step 3 was choosing what to eat. The lion showed me the menu. Fresh today, free-range muskrat, wombats, organic iguana, all-you-can-eat antelope, grass-fed gnu, sloth, or prairie-raised anteater, and wild warthog. Are there any specials, I asked, you know, like spaghetti? The lion growled, we don't eat spaghetti. Step 4 was prowling around. We crept through the woods, trying to be invisible. We hid in the bushes. I can see your tail, said the lion. We hid behind trees. Your tail, said the lion. I can still see it. There. Step five was sprinting. Do you see that tree, said the lion. I looked around. You mean the little one here? No, said the lion. The big one on that faraway hill. I'll meet you there in 5 minutes. It took me an hour. You need to hit the gym, said the lion. Step six was pouncing. It's simple, said the lion. You get a running start, and then you jump on that lady. But I'll scare her to death. That's the idea, said the lion. So I got a running start and pounced. Oh, what a cute little kitty cat, said the lady. Are you lost? Meow, I said. The lion checked my scores. This is not very promising. Step seven was looking out for your friends. Right away, I spotted a kitten. Friend or foe, said the lion. That's easy, I said. Friend. What about that dog? I let out a ferocious roar. Roar! I bared my claws. I gnashed my teeth. I pawed the ground. I shook my mane, and then I sprinted across the field as fast as I could. And I pounced exactly like, well, you know, a lion. Bravo, said the lion. And that's how I got my diploma. I'm very proud of it, except now the neighborhood cats won't leave me alone. The end.
Oh, that was great. I like that. And I have a book about another kind of animal. Well, or something. It's called Nobody Likes a Goblin, and it's by Ben Hatke. Nobody likes a goblin. Deep in a dungeon, the bats were sleeping soundly. And Goblin woke to a new day. He lit the torches, he fed the rats. He gnawed on an old boot for breakfast. And he thought about the day ahead. I think I'll go see Skeleton, said Goblin. Skeleton lived in the treasure room, and he was Goblin's very best friend. They counted bats, they played roll the dice, and Skeleton told Goblin stories from the days when he was a mighty warrior. He even let Goblin try on his old crown. Look at me, said Goblin. I'm the Goblin King. But then came the sound of boots on stone. Adventurers were storming the dungeon. They scared the rats. They knocked over the torches. They plundered the pantry. Goblin hid under his bed until they went away. The adventurers took everything. They took the gold, they took the maps, the books, the gems, and the scrolls. And they took Skeleton. So Goblin put on his crown and walked out into the wide world to find his friend. Goblin had one neighbor, a hill troll that lived in a cave nearby. I'm looking for my friend Skeleton, Goblin told him.
I saw your friend, said the troll. He was with the adventurers who took my honky-honk away over the mountain.
I'll get your honky-honk back, said Goblin.
Be careful, said the troll. Nobody likes a goblin.
I'll be okay, said Goblin. And he walked up into the hills. And away over the mountains. On the far side of the mountains, Goblin met a farmer. I'm looking for my friend Skeleton, said Goblin. Ah! Shrieked the farmer. A filthy goblin! and he chased Goblin down the road. The farmer chased Goblin right through an inn full of elves.
"Ugh," said the innkeeper, "a disgusting little goblin."
"Catch it," cried the elves.
And they tried.
The farmer, the innkeeper, and the elves chased Goblin to the edge of the haunted swamp, and there the goblin saw the adventurers pulling a cartload of spoils, and sitting atop the treasure was
Skeleton, shouted Goblin.
"Get that goblin," shouted everyone.
Goblin grabbed hold of his friend and ran.
Goblin and Skeleton ran through the haunted swamp until they passed a cave.
"We'll hide in here," said Goblin.
"They're looking for us," said Skeleton. "They will find us soon."
"I know," said Goblin.
"Troll was right. Nobody likes a goblin."
"Well, I like a goblin," said Skeleton.
And the two friends sat together and waited for their doom. But then,
"Excuse me,"
said a voice from the back of the cave.
Goblin turned and saw many eyes staring at him from the darkness.
"Do you know who likes a goblin?"
said the voice.
"More goblins!"
"We saw your crown," said the other goblins. "Are you the Goblin King?" Goblin thought for a moment.
"Yes," he said. "Yes, I am."
"We must defend the Goblin King," said the other goblins.
And they did. The farmer, the innkeeper, and the elves ran for the hills, and the adventurers, well, they were never heard from again.
Gobble.
And so, Goblin and Skeleton and their new friends traveled together back through the swamp, up the road, over the mountains, down the hill, and home to the dungeon. The end.
Thank you.
I like that story.
All over Pocatello and Chubbuck. Students are back in school.
Yes.
And studying. And here we have a book about Gus's favorite pets, with an S. And this is his report to his teacher. This story was written by Jean Birdsall and the pictures by Harry Bliss. My favorite pets. Ms. Molinsky reports due today. Here is Gus's report. My favorite pet is sheep. We have 17 in our yard. 17 sheep are still sheep, not sheeps. A boy sheep is a ram. He has horns. The horns do not come off. A girl sheep is a ewe. If you say, "Hey, you," she won't answer, even if you shout it. A baby sheep is a lamb. If you trade your little brother for a lamb, your mother will say, "Why is Sammy covered in hay?" Sheep look silly with pajamas on their heads, especially your little brother's favorite porpoise pajamas. They also look silly in a scarf and will wreck it. Your mother will say, "Gus, isn't that the scarf Mrs. Smolensky loaned you when you lost yours?" Chomp, chomp. Sheep live outside even when it rains. If you use a sheep for an umbrella, your father will say, "Holy cow, Gus, how did you get so dirty?" Sheep have wool instead of hair. If you cut some off, your mother will say, "Gus, give me the scissors this instant. You should know better." You're too big to ride on sheep, but your little brother isn't. He will cry, and your father will say, "What were you thinking, Gus?" Sheep won't ride a skateboard, no matter how long you teach them, or a bicycle. They also will not climb a tree. You can't put sheep into a wheelbarrow. You can't put them into a car, even a big car. You can get sheep into your house, but they won't like the kitchen. They will think the rug is grass and try to eat it. They will also eat your mother's orchids. They won't eat your little brother. He'll still cry. Your mother will say, "But we were only upstairs for a minute." You can tell them it's your little brother's fault. You will get sent to your room anyway. Your father will say, "You've gone too far this time, Gus." Later, your father will come to your room and say, "Now, Gus, I don't want you hanging out with the window talking to the sheep all afternoon." Gus, Gus, Gus! My Favorite Pets by Gus W. for Ms. Smolinski's class. And here is his grade. B+. Handwriting shows some improvement, Gus. Please tell your mother thank you for the chocolates and the new scarf. Ms. Smolinski. The end.
Oh, that's sweet.
I love those illustrations.
Yes. And here is an interesting book. Okay. This is called The Watermelon Seed. It's by Greg Pizzoli. Oh, look at that delicious watermelon. Oh my, it has a bite out of it. Here we go. The Watermelon Seed. I love watermelon. Tump, tump, tump. It's the best. Ever since I was a teeny tiny baby crocodile, it's been my favorite. Chomp, slurp, chomp. I like it for breakfast. I like it for lunch. I like a big salty slab for dinner. And I love it for dessert. I love watermelon. Gulp. I just swallowed a seed. I swallowed a seed! It's growing in my guts. Soon vines will come out of my ears. My stomach will stretch. My skin will turn pink. I don't want to be in a fruit salad. Somebody, please help me. Grumble, grumble. Oh no, I can feel it growing inside me. It's happening right now. My stomach feels funny. Burp. And look. Oh, here's the seed. That was too close. No more melon for me. Never again. Well, maybe just a teeny tiny bite. Chomp, chomp, chomp. Oh, the end. Oh,
that's a great book. How about we read a story called Night Animals, written by Gianna Marino. Ooh, eyes in the dark. Night animals. Hey, Possum, what are you doing in there?
Shh, I'm hiding.
What are we hiding from? Night animals. Now keep quiet. Can you move over? Let's find somewhere else. Sigh. Did you hear something? Are you trying to scare me? Aroo! Help me! Help you? You're a wolf! But something is following me. What is it? It's big and hairy, with long, sharp claws. I'm not here. You guys gotta help me. Something huge is coming. What can be bigger than a bear? Why is the sky getting darker? Night animal! Run! Hide! Stop! What are you so scared of? We're scared of night animals. But you are night animals. Oh. Did you hear something? Green tent. Click. Run, run, run. The end.
Oh, that's cute.
Cute little shrimp.
Yes. Now, the first book I read was a book about Sophie, and she had a squash. And now it's the next year, and Sophie's squash is going to go to school.
Sequel.
This is also by Pat Zietlow Miller and Annie Wiltsdorf. Here we go. On the first day of school, Sophie Peck peeked into her classroom. Kids were everywhere, talking, laughing, bouncing. "You'll make lots of friends," said her mother. Sophie clutched her backpack. "I won't," she said. "You'll have tons of fun," said her father. But Sophie didn't. The chairs were uncomfortable. The milk tasted funny. And no one appreciated her two best friends, Bonnie and Baxter. "Are those toys?" asked Leah. "Do they bounce?" asked Robin. "Can we eat them?" asked Noreen. "No," said Sophie. "No, no, no. I grew them in my garden. They're my friends." And then there was Stephen Green. He sat by Sophie at circle time, played near Sophie during recess, and watched while Sophie painted. "Stop breathing on me," Sophie said. "Stephen's just trying to be nice," said Mrs. Park. But Sophie wasn't interested. So the next time Stephen appeared, Sophie bounced Bonnie and Baxter on her knees and said, "I already have friends." "Me too," Stephen said. He pulled a stuffed frog from behind his back. "I got Marvin when he was a tadpole." Sophie nodded. "Then you don't need me." Well, she thought, that's that. But the next day, while she was building a tower, Stephen worked on a puzzle nearby. The day after that, he peered over Sophie's shoulder when she looked at books. He even chimed in with little-known facts when it was Sophie's turn to show and tell. "Actually, squash are fruits, not vegetables." Sophie's parents were no help at all. "Stephen sounds adorable," said her mother. "And it's good to have friends. Especially human ones," added her father. Sophie hugged Bonnie and Baxter tightly. "I have all the friends I need." Still, Sophie knew Bonnie and Baxter wouldn't last forever. So when Liam showed everyone how to do his loose tooth dance, Sophie considered joining in. When Roshni spilled her milk, Sophie almost shared her napkin. And when Noreen told her favorite banana joke, Sophie laughed inside her head. "Why are bananas never lonely?" "Because they hang out in bunches." Ha ha ha! But during recess, Liam, Roshni, and Noreen jumped rope while Sophie played hopscotch with Bonnie and Baxter. "Can we play too?" asked Stephen Green. "Marvin's good at hopping." "Sorry," said Sophie. "Frogs make Baxter sneeze." So Stephen sat alone. That weekend, Bonnie and Baxter looked too tired to hop or build towers. "It's time," said Sophie's mother. Sophie made a garden bed and tucked her squash in for their winter nap. "Sleep tight," she said. "See you soon." But spring seemed very far away. On Monday, Sophie drew squash babies until Mrs. Park asked an interesting question. What makes a good friend? They play with you, said Liam. They help you, suggested Roshni. They think you're funny, answered Noreen. They like what you like, said Stephen Green. Great answers, said Mrs. Park. Let's draw pictures of our friends. Sophie drew Bonnie and Baxter. She was sprinkling matching glitter when Stephen Green appeared. Can I see? No, said Sophie. It's private. Please, Stephen tugged the picture. Sophie tugged back. And they tugged at the same time. Rip. Sophie tried not to cry. For the rest of the day, Sophie didn't talk to Stephen Green. She didn't talk to anyone. I'm sorry. I tore your picture, she said. Said Stephen. But he is not a good friend, Sophie said. And neither is his frog. The next morning, Sophie found Marvin in her cubby holding an envelope. Hop somewhere else, she said. And by lunchtime, he had. When Sophie's father opened her backpack that night, Marvin and his envelope were inside. Sugar Plum, he said. This must be for you. Sophie opened the envelope. She found a picture of Bonnie and Baxter and a packet of seeds. Do friends really like the same things you like? She asked her father. Sometimes, said Sophie's father. Sophie thought for a long time. Then she took Marvin outside and sat by Bonnie and Baxter and thought some more. As soon as she got to school, Sophie found Stephen Green. Your frog had a great idea, she said. And she whispered it in his ear. During recess, Sophie, Stephen, and Marvin sat with Mrs. Park. The next day, Mrs. Park gave everyone a cup, some dirt, and one small seed. What are these? Noreen asked. You'll see, Sophie replied. Can we eat them? No, Sophie said. You never eat a friend, said Stephen. Soon the seeds were planted in dirt-filled pots. Stephen added water and Sophie set them in the sun. Nothing happened, said Roshni. But before too long, shoots appeared. Seeds, Sophie told Stephen. Sometimes growing a friend just takes time. The end. And that's the end of our program. Come to the library and we will see you there. Goodbye.